So for today's session, Art and Visual Archives in Asia, we'll be joined by Dr. Pan Liu, Shimada Yoshiko, and Professor Cho Jun Hong, also moderated by Dr. Pan Liu. So I will now turn the time over to Dr. Pan. Thank you.
Okay, 谢谢 David. 那我们今天来到第三场，这个整个论坛的第三场，那也是再次感谢上面两场也听的朋友，然后也欢迎专门来听我们这个 session 的朋友们。那今天我们这个 session 的安排呢，是当然也是由我来主持，但是我也会是其中一位讲者。那么这个我们三位啊，我然后岛田美子和曹朱贤，我们三位其实都是与一本由我编写的书相关，所以这个其实这个panel 这个 session 是关于一本书的，所以我现在就想先来 share 我的 screen， OK。那这本书的名字呢就叫艺术档案括号库的可能与不可能亚洲的理论和经验。那其实这个我看一下。对，那么这本书其实是基于我个人大概在2016年、2017年左右已经开始去构想的一个研究，就是关于档案库、艺术档案库的这样的一个研究计划。那么这个研究计划其实本身是来自于一个我的一个小小的一个反抗。这个反抗呢，是因为我其实我自己原来的这个研究的或者学术的训练的背景是文学和语言学的。那所以呢，我其实在这个档案研究方面我是非常不太熟悉，但是呢我当时呢我就在申请一个香港政府的一个研究经费，那么当时来指导我们申请写书写申请计划的一位老师呢是非常著名的一位香港的一个历史学家，那么我把计划书给他看了之后呢，他就非常严厉的批评了我，因为他告诉我说你的这个研究你要做的所有的这些东西完全没有依赖任何的档案资料。那这句话给了我一个很大的一个冲击，因为可能我之前的学术训练里面其实用到档案或者去档案库这样的一个身体的行为其实是不多的，或者基本是没有的。但是对于历史学家来说，对于就是说研究历史的这个学者来说，这个是一个基本功。那么当时我听了之后，其实我也觉得对，我必须听这位老前辈的话，我得去翻翻档案。但是同一时间我也产生了一个问题，就是说当我们做历史研究的时候，我们做一个非常久远的一个历史时期的一个研究的时候，那我们去依赖的一些资料，那很大一部分是来自于这样的档案库。那这样的档案库其实通常我们是指的是官方的档案库。那我后来自己也去做了差不多的这样的一些研究，但是同一时间我也不断的在脑子里思考这个问题，就是档案库究竟是什么。因为我比如说我去上海的档案库，我去伦敦的档案库，那我发现不同的这个档案库的这个所谓的开放性是不一样的。比如说我在伦敦它的这个国立的这个档案库 National Archives， 它所有的这些档案你几乎可以你只要给它一个号码它拿出来，然后你可以随意的拍摄照片，然后它是一个非常巨大的量，也是非常巨大，但它的开放性是很强的。但是我去到一些其他的地方它就未必会能把这个档案完完整整的就是开放给你看。有一次我在台湾 我说我想看你的材料，然后他说如果你不是一个在地的这个居民，我们就没有办法放给你看。所以我自己有很多对于档案库究竟是什么的这个问题，反而比我去档案库去获取某一种似乎是历史真相的这样的一种欲望要更强烈。所以那个时候我就开始说，我来尝试写一点文章或者做一些研究，是关于档案库究竟是什么。然后尤其是档案库在这个比如说汉语的语境之下，它究竟意味着什么。然后但是当然我做的这个档案库也是比较集中于视觉听觉就是艺术相关的这种档案库，而不是所有的档案库。那么这本书其实是一个合集，也就是说我是编辑，然后香港的一位艺术家李继忠是副编辑，然后呢我们一起召集了很多的亚洲各地不同的人来写他们对于档案和档案库在亚洲的一些思考的一些文章。那么这本书其实两年前已经完稿，然后交给了这个上海社科研究出版社，然后封面也已经都设计好了，但是因为种种的原因吧，到现在为止这本书还不能够与观众见面就是读者见面。那么到底什么时候出版其实我们也还不知道。那么所以但是我们觉得可能这个书它的这个里边的这个讨论到的这些话题，我觉得可能现在我们就已经可以开始逐步的跟大家分享了。那首先我想先跟大家分享一下，就是说我刚刚提到的这个问题，就是关于这个档案或者档案库这个概念尤其是在它被翻译过来的时候，从英文或者是一个西方的这个语系去翻译过来的时候，它的这个有什么东西是一样的，但又有什么东西其实是只是属于中文这个语言的。那这个方面的研究其实我大概从2017年2018年开始已经在不同的场合分享过了，所以如果有朋友听过了的话也请多多包涵。那我其实还是在讲我之前的一个研究。那其实大概也就是从那个几年前开始吧，就是我也意识到，就是在这个不论是华语的还是其他亚洲地区的这个当代艺术的领域里边，档案似乎成为了一个非常热门的一个字眼，是一个 keyword。那很多的这个艺术家也好，策展人也好，也开始会去提到档案，因为正如我之前讲，就是说档案之前似乎只是存在于历史学家的这样的一个研究方法论里面。那么当代艺术它的对于这个档案的这样的一种热情，其实我们也在刚才马然老师和孙松荣老师的这个作品里边我们也看到了。那我在这个对于这个档案在当代艺术界的这样的一个流通的这种观察来看，很多时候即使是在亚洲的语境里边很常用的一个理论框架，在这个讨论档案的时候很常用的理论框架是比方说德里达 Derrida 的这个archive fever， 那就是叫灼热的档案灼热的档案。这个不是说档案热就是好像很流行我们今天流行讲档案了叫档案热，这个翻译可能会有一些歧义。其实我觉得这个更接近于一个叫发烫的烫手的一个档案这样的一个概念。当然这个概念其实也是大家可以在欧洲跟美国的这个跟档案相关的这样的一些策展的论述里边也可以看到。那德里达他说这个 archive 这个英文的这个字，或者是这个在希腊语里边的这样的一个词根到底是什么意思呢？他说有两种意思，一个是开始一个是一种戒律或者是一种律法。那这个其实我们也可以理解的，因为就是说我们想到档案它似乎也是一个 某一种开始，是因为它是好像去它当然是一个人为建构起来的一个空间嘛，一个巨大的一个像一个仓库一样的东西。那然后它其实是带有一定的这样的一种权威性在里面。那么他说archive 说他德里达继续说 archive 其实有两种的，那一种就是一种是跟开始相关的这种 archive， 那就是好像是我们去到一个考古的现场，我们看到这个洞穴里边的这个壁画，那这个也是一种 archive。 那么还有一个呢，就是跟律法相关的这种呢是跟权力跟权威相关的这样的一种 archive。 那我们其实在当代的就现代的社会里边更多看到的这种 archive 似乎是跟后面的一种定义关系更加密切。那么他还说就是 archive 是有很多不同的符号标记所汇成的，那里边它有文字，这个符号标记可能是文字，可能是图像，甚至可能是声音啊。那我觉得最有意思的一点是他在这个他为什么要讲这个灼热的档案，他讲这种烫手的档案，是他认为这个档案其实我们通常认为档案那就是为了保存嘛，我要留存我们这个族群的或者是这个共同体的以前的历史，让后面的人不要忘记，所以我们才有档案。但是他说其实档案本身还有一种非常强烈的所谓叫死亡的冲动，所以它是发热的。它这个档案我们似乎看它好像非常冷静的非常安静的被保管在那里，可是你不知道的它有一天它会自己燃烧起来，就是它是有这样的一种死亡冲动。那我觉得这个是我们值得去思考的，就是它的这样的一个矛盾体，就是在德里达的这样的一个定义之下，档案是有这样的一种双重性的。那我觉得这个定义没有问题，然后我们也可以在我们即使在这个亚洲的这个语境当中用，但是我还是会有一点点小的疑问，就是说因为我们去讲档案库的时候，我们不是用 archive 这个词，这个等一下我还是会让那个岛田女士和这个曹女士两位去聊一下日语跟韩语当中这个 archive 这个英文词在不同的亚洲语言当中究竟会被怎么样子翻译，或者它的含义会是怎么样。那我自己就在想，中文其实它不是一个，就是它没有把 archive 这个字翻译成 archive符这样的一个表音的字，而是他用了一个中文里边现有的一个词汇来进行翻译。那么其实是有两种或者更多的翻译方法。那我现在先举两个我觉得特别有意思的例子，一个就是文献库啊，比如说香港的这个 Asian Art Archive 叫亚洲艺术文献库，然后还有一种就是更多的我们会用到的叫档案库。那么我就在琢磨，就是文献和档案这两个字究竟是怎么回事？我没有从来没有想过，在做这个研究之前，从来没有想过这两个字是怎么回事。那文献嘛，就是一堆像那个出土文献，对不对？这个听上去就有点像德里达说的第一种定义里边的这个 archive 的意思了，出土文献或者是一个早的一个历史的一个所谓记录的东西叫文献。但是我开始查词海或者去查文献这两个字的这样的一个渊源的时候，我有点惊呆了，因为文献这两个字原来它饱含的这样的一个意义其实是跟德里达的这样的一个 archive 的这个含义是非常不一样的。那文没有问题，文就是一种书写啊，它也可以是一种经典，甚至是图录，也可以是一种甚至是一种这个统治性的书写。其实我们这个 chat 就是关于纺织的。那么其实还有一个也是关于这个文理，它有那个绞丝旁，其实文这个字其实也是和这个纺织跟这个线有非常重要的联系，这个我不多讲，但是文基本上我们有这样的一个理解。但线就特别有意思，线原来在这个文献这个字里边，甚至它可以通弦这个字啊，弦这个字其实就是指一个这个 man of wisdom， 就是它是有一个学识的，有智慧的，甚至它就是直指孔子本人的。在这个儒家的这样的一个思想的 知识的体系的结构里面。那么所以所以这个文献就是文是一个 text， 文是一个东西，但是线其实是一个人，也所以文献这个东西其实它是不光光是一个文本，它是文本加上一个人对这个文本的一个解释，这个是文献的最初的意思。我有点被惊到了。那而且这个时间性也是跟这个我觉得那个 archive 的英文里边的这样的一种，它几乎不去很强调它的时间性，它更多的是一种空间性的一个空间，这样的一个 archive 的那种想象方法是完全不一样。文献是后面有一个人他在解释前朝的或者前代的一些文本，那他这个文本的解释本身有可能会被再后来的一个线一个弦一个人去解释，而这个解释本身也变成了文献的一部分。也就是说它的时间性是不断在向前推进跟重叠的，这样的东西我们称之为叫做文献。这个是我觉得特别特别没有想到的，就是在我们汉语里边汉字里面它会有这样的一个隐含的这个意义。那第二个就更让我惊讶，就是我们现在就是更常用的，我们去讲 archive 翻译的时候，我们就会用这个词叫档案。我也没有很具体的想过档案究竟这两个字是什么意思。以前读古代汉语的时候，基本的知道案是桌子的意思，对吧？但是档是什么，我也没有仔细的想过。那么我也做了点研究之后，就我更惊讶了。那么档案它其实是一个新的词，是一个其实相对来说跟文献相比，文献已经存在了可能上千年了，但是档案其实是一个相对来说现代的词汇。那这个词汇首先是第一次可能是出现在这样一本书，叫做《柳编纪略》，是一个清代的一个叫杨斌的人写的。那他其实是在这个去描述当时就是说满洲的这样的一个关内关外的这个边境的一些像一个边境记录者他有一点地理意味，但是他也有一点这个就是像一个纪实的这样的一个书吧。那么里边他用到了档案这个词。那然后再查下去说，那么到底档案是什么？然后我就发现说档案也是两部分组成的。刚才文献是一个文一个线，那么档案呢，它这两个这词都是名词，但是它的语言是不同的。档其实是直接来自于满文，那么它原来这个词叫 当子，这它原来是一个像是一个木条，这个木条上面记录着什么呢？就是在一些满族的这个仪式一些宗教仪式上，他会去让这个祭祀去写下这个仪式当中的一些事情，那么这些木条被称为档子。那么所以它这个是一个满语，然后呢案呢是一个汉语。那么案它是由桌子衍生为说一个也是像一个文档一样的一个概念，一个文案这样的一个概念，就是文案加档子。然后所以说档案其实是一个外来语半外来语，就是满语加汉语的组合，一直到清文鉴这本字典才把这两个语言的这个融合起来的这个词源就统一了。那么所以这也是可以看到，当时清朝它也有很多不同的这个语言的这个政策。那么我们也可以看到档案这个词是一个多语言政策下的一个产物。那么这个两个对于这两个这个翻译方法包括他们语言的这样的一个探究，让我就是产生了一个非常强烈的愿望，就是说如果说 archive 这个字这个英文字或者它与之相关的理论没有办法来完全的替代我们在亚洲语言当中所去思考和理解的这个 档案的概念的话，或者文献的概念的话，那么我们是不是仅仅就是说，我们是不是有这样的一个可能，就是说亚洲能不能也去生产出一些与档案相关的理论？这是我的一个大的一个问题。那么所以编写这本书的时候，我也就期待，就是说不同的这个作者在亚洲各地他们的这些经验能够提供这些理论生产的这个依据。那么我们这本书里边有一个特别重要的地方，是在于除了第二部分有一些我们讲到，比如说就像刚才马老师跟这个孙老师的这个讲电影的这部分，有很多艺术家和导演他们其实是在活用这个官方的档案材料，可是他们在用的时候，他们不是说顺着这个档案的这个原来的意图走的，有的时候甚至就是说基本上他们是想要去让我们去反思这些已经存在在那里的一个档案。那么除了这些之外，其实我们这本书里边包括的这个章节其实介绍了很多所谓的非官方的档案啊，那这些当然都是跟艺术和视觉啊听觉相关的一些档案库。那么所以我在自己在研究当中发现，就是说我们工作的时候研究的时候有不少英文的文献或者材料是可以让我们去依赖去书写或者去做研究，但是亚洲范围内来讲这样的一种有理论性，然后能够把很多不同类型的经验集结在一起的这样的一本书是空缺的。所以这本书其实真的是还是想要去并置并且集中讨论这样的一个问题。我觉得这是一个挺重要的一个在亚洲这个文化历史或者是当代的这个状况当中非常重要的一个话题。那么所以这些机构包括这些去生产去建立档案库的这些人，很多他都就是基本上或者说不是官方机构，它不是一个大的美术馆，不管它是官方的美术馆还是一个商业的美术馆或者博物馆或者是一个这种就是大的这种档案馆，而是很多大家可以看到很有意思，是一个人的或者是一些小的团体的或者是非盈利组织自己建立的这样的一种独立于官方之外的档案库。我觉得这些经验是非常有意思的。那么当然我们通常都在说啊，亚洲生产经验，西方生产理论，但是是不是这样呢？那么我觉得也是，我们要先从经验出发，然后我们再看一下到底有没有这个生产理论的可能性。那当然我觉得就是说在这个基础上啊，可能我们要回到这样的一个普遍性跟特殊性的问题了，就是说很多同一时期，我包括所有这本书里边的作者大家都是在与西方的档案观念有一个这样的一个碰撞的一个过程，但是有的时候就发现这些理论可以在某程度上帮助打开这个理论的这样的一个框架的思维，可是它不能够完全的说明或者是解释我们现实生活中遇到的很多具体的问题。那还有的就比方说是一些非常共有的一些殖民的经验的一些问题，或者是面对因为亚洲也是一个使用新的媒体非常集中的一个区域，然后包括人数也是可能是最大的一个区域，那么对于这些媒体的一个迅速的变化的时候我们有很多这种记忆的危机。当然还有一些不仅是亚洲的，就是包括一些灾难啊，一些其他的一个突发情况啊的这些危机之下，那么有很多时候我们其实可能全球所有的人都在面临这样的一种所谓记忆的危机。那当然这本书也不是想去证明说这个经验只属于亚洲，这是肯定不是这样子的。正如我觉得也许我们现在也已经很少再见到所谓纯粹的西方经验，我们没有办法把这些东西完全的剥离开来。但是我希望这本书可以提供这样的一个机会首先是让书中的各自在努力的在建立的在思考档案 对于亚洲是什么的人来说有一个互相看见的机会。那同一时间当然也通过这个集中想也可以给这个读者分享他们到底做了些什么，如何做的，以及我们到底还能做什么。那所以我等一下就是会给大家非常快的看一下这个书的目录。那这个目录里边大家就可以看到这个不同的这个建立档案库的初衷，比方说有的是就是为了收集艺术品，但是它并不是一定是一个像那种藏家一样的概念，因为很多藏家可能他就是不会把这个作品公开或者是他是为了投资而去收藏的。但我们这里看到的很多的这个收藏本身它其实是公开的，它甚至它就是为了公开，那它也不是以盈利作为目的的，所以它里边有各种各样的这样的一个目的。那所以它这个档案库它会涉及到各种各样的领域和我们日常的这种生活的这样的一种行动在里面。那所以有艺术品、表演艺术、艺术史、策展，还有媒介转变或者甚至个人兴趣等等等等都会形成这样的一些这个档案库的推动档案库的这样的一种建立。那么除了保存之外，档案库还作为本地或者跨地域，就是刚刚比方说马老师说的这个 translocal 的这种个人和集体之间能够产生一种连接、合作、抵抗、反思教育，然后还有一种自我疗愈的这样的一种行动的这种媒介。所以档案它不再是一个冷冰冰的一个仓库，然后你自己以为你要找到一个时间过去一个时间点的一个什么资料的时候你就能进去，你就能把那个资料调出来，不是这样的档案库我们看到的档案库是一种生命体，它是自成一体的，它是活着的。那所以我们这个档案库的这个书就分成三部分。那第一部分其实就是去看看到底大概这15年来我们亚洲各地有些什么形式的档案库。第一部分比方说有关于口述历史的然后有录像艺术的，那媒介都不一样，然后有些是跟这个殖民跟殖民地的这个，或者是去殖民，未必是殖民地了，就是去殖民本身是一个，我觉得是一个，很多地方都可以去共享的这样的一个状态。这第三篇是关于泰国的，那么还有比方说关于表演艺术怎么去这个档案化它，那因为表演是稍纵即逝的，那到底这个我们又去怎么去处理。还有一个人的档案库，就是这关于新加坡的这个他完全是靠自己的这样的一种热忱去支持这种档案库的建立。然后还有一个很有意思的是我们也是授权去翻译了一个关于自己如何动手来做一个艺术档案库的一个手册的一部分，也放在这本中英文双语的这本书里面。那一些图像这个是土方勋的这个庆应大学，日本庆应大学的所以你对于表演艺术的这个档案来说，那它的文字的图像的这些东西到底是怎么处理呢？那么是不是也是应该成为这个表演艺术的这个档案化的一部分呢？这个是许元豪的家里我跟他聊天的时候，他说他已经好像需要腾出自己住的房子留给档案，所以是一个非常疯狂的一个人。那还有这个就是这个是没有翻译的版本，但是这个就是一个日本的一个组织吧，他们就是去手绘的图绘的一个一步一步一步步教你怎么来去自己来做一个档案库的这样的一个手账。那么第二部分其实就更多的是关于这个艺术家、策展人和这个学者他们来讨论档案库。那其实这个里面就是相对来说也会有很多我觉得理论生产的可能性。那这个里边就其实涉及到刚才我提到的各种方向，就是说我们谈论档案的时候，它是一个跟各种各样的行为其实发生密切关联的一个东西。那所以 策展也好，就是展览也好，或者说书写艺术史也好，就比如说这个印度的这个，它其实关于这个印度的艺术史究竟应该怎么去书写，那么这个其实跟你怎么去分类档案，或者是怎么去选取这个档案，其实有非常密切的关系。香港的例子是一个香港的一个艺术家叫夏碧泉，那么他也是出于一种个人的一种热忱吧，他也有相当多的这样的一些不仅是作品，而且是比如说是那种所谓的展览的简介啊，或者是图册啊、杂志啊，就是总之跟香港艺术或者是那个时期六七十年代七八十年代香港艺术界正在发生的各种各样的东西的一个收藏。那董明峰老师也是会去谈到这个策展，然后刚才孙松荣老师也有一个篇章是关于这个录像艺术的，这也是一些图像。这个是夏碧泉的这个编的一本叫 Modern Art， 它这里边也有一些可能是马尔堡的一些东西。那还有这个是孙老师提到的一些档案影像。那等一下就是会有两位本书的这个作者就会来跟我们仔细的来讲这个他们各自的篇章。那第一位其实就是Shimada Yoshiko san， 那他的这个就是他是长期研究这个松泽佑，松泽佑是一个活跃在日本的这个六十年代到可能一开始吧，一直往后的一个概念艺术家。那我最近其实也翻译了Shimada san 的一个关于松泽佑档案的一个文章可大家可以就是说华语的这个世界就可以多了解一下一个非常有意思的人，我不多说了，因为等一下喜马拉雅桑会说的。那还有比如说菲律宾的然后关于档案，然后这个欧秀仪是一位马来西亚的艺术家，但他常驻台湾，然后他有一些这个剧场的这个表演，他怎么去融到这样的一个档案的这样的一个观察里面这也是菲律宾的一位声音的一个艺术家和策展人然后李继忠他自己有一些跟这个香港的历史，包括战争、东亚的这个战争相关的一些思考，还有越南的这个阮成诗的这个散文电影呢。这篇文章是也是刚刚这个马然老师写的，也是很精彩的。那这个就是等一下这个老田老师要去讲的这个松泽佑的这样的一个谱系，就是他的一个谱系，一些来自于这个其他的这个作者的一些图像这个是欧秀仪的，这个是达央，菲律宾的，这个跟声音相关的，这个是李继忠的一个作品的一个截图吧，这个是一个维多利亚女王像，那他做的东西跟这个纪念碑也相关这个是阮成诗的电影当中的一个截图，因为阮成诗他用非常多的这个实得影像 food footage 来完成他的这个影片，所以也是跟archive 跟这个档案是有非常密切的关系。那最后这一部分就是关于一个公共与想象，就是说档案库它也是一种作为一种媒介，作为一种去形成某一种社群或者共同体的一个存在。那么这里边就包括比方说仙台，就是日本的东北的这个311大地震之后的他们的这个当代艺术的这个场馆，他们如何去通过展览和档案去进行某一种疗愈吧但是也是我觉得也是类似于一种社会活动这样的一种行为。那么还有这个景英瑞老师老前辈他去给我们写了一篇关于这个台湾民间影像的保存运动，就是说很多的这个图像不是来自于官方的电视台的，而是一些私人的影像松本笃是一位日本的艺术家，那么他其实也在也是就是他甚至想去搭建一个就是说 关于非人的这种记忆，就是关于动物的这个记忆。黄孙权老师谈论他之前的一个项目，就是关于这个亚洲的这个影像资料库。然后等一下就是还有这个曹朱贤女士会给我们聊她曾经做的这样的一个在韩国做的这样一个合作式的艺术档案和这种社群之间的关系。然后最后是关于印尼的一个社群建构跟档案馆的一些趋势。那这个是一个就是仙台的他们的一个跟311相关的这样的一个展览当中的一个状态，就是一个家的状态。这个也是就是松本笃的关于大象的记忆的一个项目。这个是印尼的其实它的这个档案跟图书馆跟大家社区的一个中心其实也是融为一体了，就是有各种各样不同的这样的一个情况吧。那我自己也是几年前写过一篇文章，其实是关于这个所谓叫公的生产，共的生产，就是共有的共的生产。那么就是关于视觉档案库和这个 the common 这个又涉及到一个翻译的问题，就是说我们英文里边我们叫 common 那么这个字如果我们翻译成公或者翻译成共的时候，它的那个含义，尤其是其实同一个字，同一个公或者同一个共，同一个汉字在日语的这个语境下跟在汉语的语境下其实又有不同的这样的一个理解有这样的一个思考在里边。这是四年前的一篇文章。那么这里是一个嵌套的广告，就是说我们两个星期之后，我们其实就会以这本书来做几个系列的单独的讲座，以及这个一些所谓圆桌论坛。就是这两天如果大家有兴趣的话，可以扫我们的这个这个 SNS 这个社交媒体的这个平台来继续了解。那么孙松荣老师和马仁老师也会单独就他们的那个章节进行一个单独的章节四，所以这个如果大家有兴趣的话可以继续关注。好，那我就先讲到这里然后接下来的时间我就会交给这个交给我的另外两位这个书中的这个作者。一位第一首先是这个島田佳子さん。 OK 我先来介绍一下島田さん。那么島田佳子是1959年生于东京目前生活在千叶市。他是一位视觉艺术家和艺术史学者，他在伦敦金斯顿大学获得博士学位。他的研究兴趣包括战后日本的艺术和政治、另类艺术教育和女权主义那他目前也在东京大学教授女权主义和艺术这样的课程。那非常感谢希望大家来参与我们的这个分享活动。那时间现在就交给
Okay, thank you, Pan-san. Thank you for your introduction. So my paper today is about the archive or planned archive plan diagram of by Matsuzawa Yutaka. So let me just share my PowerPoint with you. So the Matsuzawa Yutaka is a well-known Japanese conceptual artist. He was born in Suwa. It's about 170 kilometers northwest of Tokyo in Nagano Prefecture on February 2nd, 1922, and died there in 2006. So this year is Matsuzawa's 100th year anniversary, and there is large retrospective at the Nagano Prefecture Museum. And Matsuzawa began devoting most of his practice to language-based works in 1964. Well, this is a map of Japan. So Suwa is kind of in the middle of Japan. It's in the mountain area, but there's a Suwa Lake. Anyway, after his death in 2006, Matsuda's house lay empty for almost 20 years. And most of the post-1964 materials and artworks were stored in the kura, a traditional storage building behind the house, while others were left lying here and there within the house itself. Besides Matsuda's language-based works and manuscripts, there is a vast amount of documentation of exhibitions and projects he had organized, as well as works and materials by artists from all over the world. There have been little attempt to examine the materials left in the house until a group of scholars, including myself, began investigating them in 2012. What struck me as curious was the amount of other artists' materials, which account for over half of the whole. Why did Matsuzawa gather other people's materials to such an extent? It is evident that he collected them intentionally rather than just letting them accumulate over time. So after a year of investigation, I realized that there was a trace of attempted organization of some of the materials. This diagram of an archive or archival institution of his and the other artists' work and activities was given to his student in 1974. The title of this attempted archive is Expose, and the both side arrows, total communication. Below the word expose, there are Japanese translations of the word that are: one, revealing secrets and plans; two, endangering oneself to risks, criticisms, and influences; three, being open to a certain direction; four, unmasking one's true nature; five, being exposed to the sun, wind, and rain; six, disclosing hidden areas; and seven, revealing the entirety. These indicate that Matsuda was trying to build an archive which reveals the true nature of the activities of he and his collectives, and by doing it, trying to open it to the different disciplines, analysis, and wider audience. The diagram consists of four overlapping circles. On the top right is Nirvana group activities. Below that is Bigakko. That's an alternative art school where Matsuda taught, and DCCA, that's stand for Data Center of Contemporary Art, for which Matsuzawa asked various artists to send information, and X. The time span of the diagram is roughly from 1969 to 1974, when he was most active with Nirvana, a group of artists around Matsuzawa. These 5 years also coincide with the post-1968 period in Japan, when the student movement was in decline and the dream of revolution had virtually collapsed. Some young people sought for an alternative life close to nature outside the big cities and formed various communes. This was also a period of going back to the deepest radical in the peripheral, as Ota Ryu, an ex-Force International activist, advocated. What Ota intended was to germinate a new revolutionary movement by the oppressed in the peripheral areas such as Okinawa and Hokkaido, but revolution apart, there was a general tendency to look inwards, searching for the root of one's existence. Matsuda's interest in nature and the prehistoric religion and culture of his home area of Suwa was of long standing, but it was after 1969 that he started communal activities in earnest. In 1970, he and his friends built a meditation platform on mountain land owned by the Matsuda family in Suwa, where they staged various gatherings and performance events. As seen in the diagram, Nirvana group activities were mostly staged in Suwa and surrounding area by the artists themselves, shunning any publicity or even an audience. It may seem rather an idyllic and perhaps even escapist action, but at the time it was a radical statement against a society that was promoting material wealth through the huge Osaka World Exposition of 1970 under the slogan of progress and harmony for mankind. So now let's look at each circle. The circle one is Nirvana. Matsuda organized an art exhibition titled Nirvana in 1970. It was held from August 12th to 14th at the Kyoto City Art Museum with 85 artists participating. Most of the works were conceptual and in the forms of text, photographs, plans, documents, and actions. For example, this is mail art sent by Stanley Brown. Some of the participants continued to associate with Matsuzawa and later became known as the Nirvana Group. The collective consisted of various cores. This aggregation of loosely connected independent units was what Matsuzawa advocated as a united cause. It was not the secret society or religious organization or the hierarchical cult-like group with Matsuzawa at the top of the top that it was later mistakenly thought to be. The We Nirvana Manifesto, written in 1972-73 by Matsuzawa, said, Nirvana can be described as a united moving bodies. It is a commune-like collision of moving bodies that have different foundation philosophies, geographical and situational backgrounds. Each body has its core. The core has relatively equal centripetal and centrifugal movements. Both movements should be respected. At the extreme of the centripetal movement, each core's expression, attitude, mind, and desire can be co-owned by all. But even when the cores have centrifugal movement, each should keep a friendly eye on others, give advice, cooperate, sympathize, accept, and reach out to co-own one another. So they are to work, research, and create together. They organized various exhibitions between 1969 and 74, which were listed in a diagram in the chronological order. It includes the End of the Illusion Named Art exhibition in 1969, Nirvana exhibition, Onge, that was outdoor sound and performance event in 1971. This is the group communal picture of Onge, where they performed in the middle of night without audience or by themselves. And also World Uprising, they organized an international mail art project between 1971 and 74, and two exhibitions, Being Open and Catastrophe Art in 1972. Okay, and another circle in the diagram is Bigakko. Bigakko is an alternative art school in Tokyo, established in 1969 by Gendai Shichosha, a radical publishing company founded by in 1957 by Ishii Kyoji. Matsuda taught a class titled The Final Art Thought, there from 1970 to 1980. His class curriculum took up a different subject each week, such as esoteric Buddhism, eschatology, semantics, anarchism, utopia, etc. The students were to read about these topics, and then one of them would make an oral presentation followed by class discussion. Documentation of the work and thought process of this class would be a part of the planned archive. Apart from his class, Matsuda's diagram also include education on design, dance, music, film, and theater, all of which were taught at Bigakko. The director Ishii had an ambitious plan to franchise Bigakko all over Japan. The plan was to found branches of Bigakko in places where teachers lived, and by organically connecting these autonomous teacher-student cells to spread Bigakko into various locations. In 1973, Bigakko Suwa opened with the final art thought class taught by Matsuzawa and contemporary music taught by Kosugi Takehisa. The brochure introducing Matsuzawa's class states, Matsuzawa Yutaka, who is feared and respected as one of the most extreme art thinkers, is going to give a workshop from September 1973. His curriculum will touch the radical questions concerning artistic expressions, such as what is the ultimate state of art attainable by thought, and whether art making is possible at all. And the third circle in the diagram is DCCA, Data Center of Contemporary Art. This imaginary center was established by Matsuzawa using Bigakko as its mailing address. He sent out letters to his artist friends and institutions overseas, asking them to send information about their works and activities. He intended to create a database of all these artists and institutions. DCCA was to archive their information, materials, and documentation in the forms of actual works, text, memos, audio tapes, photographs, film and video, magazines, and catalogs. The institutions that responded to his request, including CAYC here, that's institution in Argentina, Head Museum of Finland, SUM in Iceland, WORKS in Canada, Art and Project of Netherlands, Image Bank, US, File Magazine of Canada, Something Else Press, Accumulatory 2 Gallery in Poland, etc. And many artists from all over the world send Matsuzawa their cards, mail art, catalogs, including prominent international conceptual artists such as Lawrence Wiener, Douglas Hubler, Gilbert and George, and the Fluxus artist Dick Higgins and George Matunas, to name a few. Matsuzawa's intention was for the DCCA to plan exhibitions, seminars, lectures, conferences, and artist and institutional exchanges. It was also to publish newsletters, magazines, annuals, book of theories, anthologies, and monographs. This is one example, the catalog Catastrophe Art and newsletter of Nirvana Exhibition. The aim was to even to have facilities for silkscreen and other printing and film video workshops, as well as to provide spaces for meetings, research, and storage. And the circle X, the fourth one. There's an in and out allo that indicate exchange of ideas on language, philosophy, science, religion, art, everyday reality, and other genres. This part X was to be open to those different disciplines and the outside world. Another in and out, the arrow indicates movement of a large number of people. As early as 1956, Matsuzawa was writing about the importance of an interdisciplinary approach, as in a letter to an art critic, Takiguchi Shuzo. Matsuzawa wrote, "In order to enforce the power of art to appeal to all human beings, we need to fill the gap between different disciplines such as art, science, and philosophy. In order to achieve it, it is necessary to take cybernetics seriously in art. This issue of communication requires further examination. If not, artistic expression will be inadequate." Had it been realized, this exposed total communication would have become the first artist-run archive-based research institution in Japan. In the later 1970s, Matsuzawa attempted to catalog all the materials sent to him, but it seems that his interest gradually waned and the bulk of the materials were left piled up in the storage house. Why he abandoned this idea of creating archive is still unclear. But even though it was not materialized, Matsuzawa's interest in creating an archive and a research institution based around it was quite innovative in the 1970s, when the word and concept of archive was unknown in Japanese art circles. In order to understand Matsuzawa's intention in proposing this archive, it is important to examine how he defined art. For Matsuzawa, art is not expression of artist self. Rather, art starts from dissolution of artist self. There is no longer a hierarchical value system, and everything is equal and infinitely free, even from material restrictions. Expose total communication was to accumulate this kind of free art from all over the world. But what is free art? Does it mean that anything can be art? His call for contribution to DCCA did not specify what kind of art should be submitted. Although Matsuzawa knew most of the artists and institutions he wrote to, his request was quite open-ended. They could send anything related to their work or themselves. What Matsuzawa was aiming for in accumulating documentation can be seen in a memo he wrote about 2 years later, in which he used the term free document instead of art. He wrote, "It is better to call it a document than art. Anything can be included in that. Therefore, it is absolutely free, free document. After one's death, a collection of things, including incidents and thought he believed in, would be extremely valuable heritage for human consciousness in the future. Yes, it would be the next art. I came up with this thought at 4 a.m. on January 24, 1972. Matsuzawa then further explained what he meant by free document in relation to death in another undated memo. He wrote, "As it is inevitable that we will die, we strive to leave something behind, anything. It doesn't have to be art. In all of or in preparation for death, we want to leave something. Or even we don't have to actually leave a thing. We are driven to do something as we felt death in the most sensitive part of our heart. It can be evidence of our lives in the form of any petty thing or action. And that is what I call the fundamental of art. We regarded art as something gorgeous, exuberant, and valuable, and preserved such things. But other than those treasured, they have been smaller but nobler things, actions, and thought that were dedicated to death. They are the final proof of our lives as human beings. These things and actions will remain even after humanity has disappeared. Here, Matsuzawa declared that a document that replaced art was a proof of one's life, which could be a small thought, a slight gesture in the face of death. These immaterial documents would be the proof of our existence long after our material existence ends. Matsuzawa's understanding art here is quite different from accepted definition of at the time, or even now. To achieve such art document proof was not to treasure artists' works and preserve their legacies as museums and other institutions intend to do. Rather, it was to record art as a primordial li or action in the face of death, as a proof of life. So in a way, Matsuzawa's idea was very much ahead of his time. Matsuzawa was very interested in scientific development, especially in cybernetics. He mentioned its importance already in 1956 in his letter to Takiguchi. He wrote about mail art as communication that creates an imaginary space, and that in the future, telepathic immaterial communication would be realized. Matsuzawa perhaps intuited the future of communication in cyberspace, but did not live to fully utilize the technology. If he had been born in the internet age, his plan for the exposed total communication archive would have been quite viable. Documents could have been gathered not only from the artist's friends, but also from a much wider spectrum, in larger numbers and easily shared. So Matsuzawa's imagined archive is not to pay homage to Matsuzawa alone, nor to be a collection of valued objects. It should be an active archive where materials and information can be examined, reinterpreted, and renewed. It should not be confined to art and art history, but rather should expose itself to different fields of study. Such fluidity is perhaps unimaginable to most art institutions in Japan, but I believe that Matsuzawa's vision of archive should be recognized in the future. From 2018 to 2020, Matsuzawa Yutaka Psyloom Foundation, of which I served as a director, and Tokyo Bunkazai Kenkyujo, Tokyo National Research Institute for Cultural Properties, collaborate on listing and some digitalization of Matsuzawa's materials. So it is our hope to realize the cyber version of Expose Total Communication Archive and make it available to public in the future. Thank you very much.
Okay. 那非常感谢Smada-san 给我们做的这个介绍啊，因为这个项目其实我也因为这个 Smada-san 的关系啊，2018年的时候跟着他一起去了一次啊，这个松泽的这个在长野县取访的这个旧宅，那也去看到了他的一些收藏，那还是非常震撼的，因为他2006年去世之后，他的一间房间里面的很多的东西也就没有再碰过了，就是他保持了这个原状。那么他的这个房间本身也似乎变成了一种档案的状态。当然我刚刚听喜马拉雅桑在讲的过程当中，我觉得其实松泽的整个的一个对于档案的想法，其实是 非常好的，可以呼应德里达之前我介绍的这个死亡冲动的这样的一个理论，但是它其实是有进一步的延伸啊、就是说它的这个它把档案跟人都就是放在同一个它没并没有区分啊、就是说人跟档案之间的这样的一个绝对的这样的一个鸿沟，但是它的这个档案肯定也像人的生命和死亡一样。不断的是处在一种流动的活跃的开放的这样的一种状况之下，那我觉得其实这个案例也可以给我们很多提示。那接下来一位讲者这个曹朱贤女士，她是目前是这个综合平台Drifting Colloquium 的成员与策展总监这个平台以新的学习形式进行多学科的策展研究和项目和实验。他亦担任延世大学传讯与艺术研究院文化媒体特聘教授，并在韩国科学技术院人类世研究中心担任副研究员。那曹女士她基于她敏锐的这个当代叙事的这个研究通过过去五年来一直在一鸣美术馆策划和监督的十多个重要的展览项目以及出版物以极具实验性的形式捕捉并且呈现了紧迫的社会议题中被遮蔽的部分另外她也一直在展览中策划通过戏剧表演后戏剧和游戏等多样的这个媒体实验在观众参与、社区和档案艺术等领域寻求新的艺术形式。那么今天他要给我们分享的也是我们这本书里边的由曹女士她写的这样的一个章节，那么是更多的关于这个档案和社区的建构的这样的一个经验。好，那我现在就把时间交给曹朱贤。
Okay, thank you for introducing me. I'm Ju Hyun Jo, a curator and researcher in Korea. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Pan Lu and the curator Wei Wei Wang at TAT Hong Kong for giving me this opportunity to present at this meaningful event. I will show my presentation PPT file. Okay. Oops. Okay, well, I really enjoyed listening to Professor Yoshiko Shimada's interesting presentation. I think there will be a point where my presentation resonates with the archive that Matsuzawa Yutaka long dreamed of. In this presentation, I'd like to introduce an exhibition on community archives that I curated in 2017 at the Ilmi Museum of Art in Seoul, where I worked as the chief curator until last year. Actually, community is a very comprehensive theme, but given that the digital commons have become more influential since the pandemic, I'd like to revisit the characteristics of community within the East Asian tradition and history, especially through the methodology of archiving. So why the community archives? 2017 was a very symbolic year in Korean modern and contemporary history. In April of that year, Candlelight Revolution led to the impeachment of then President Park Geun-hye. She is the daughter of President Park Jong-hee, who led Korea's industrialization in the 1960s and 70s, and the center of far-right forces. That year was the time when Koreans were rapidly filled with pride that we realized the power of voluntary solidarity of independent subjects. Such a move was not sudden, of course. Throughout the 2010s, discussions on the new notion of community were actively conducted in Korean society. In 2008, where the Lehman Brothers collapse led to the global financial crisis, the millennials were thrown into a dark reality without an exit, an unequal and unfair world. People gradually began to realize this was something that was caused by the trend of neoconservatism, also known as neoliberalism. This created desperate need to find something to offset extreme individualism and egoism and made people turn to community-centered value. This exhibition was curated to examine and focus on the new movements of community centered on voluntary solidarity and participation in Korea and the international community since the 2010s. Methodologically, it was developed around the notion of anti-archiving and participatory living archives for the production of knowledge culture from below. In this exhibition, a community study of 8 researchers was organized along with more than 20 teams of artists. Although research-based works of this exhibition introduced numerous narrative and history, in this exhibition, I will focus on introducing the overall structure of the archiving methodology rather than introducing their narrative one by one. The exhibition consists of 3 sections, and the first section is archive as a process, transforming and growing. Most documentation on communities are not preserved as historical documents or historical records, are rather based on people's memories and oral statements, and are left as traces engraved in rhythms of life, such as sound, dance, and rhythm. The first section of the exhibition presented a plateau-like stage, inducing people natural movement. It was to create a situation where spectators gathering around specific incidents or archives could temporarily unite or intervene in the historical communities. Spectators gathered in 3 or 4 around the exhibition hall, presenting documentary films, sound recordings, interviews, photographs, music scores, research materials, and visual art objects related to communities led to people to make resistant history and watch occasional recitations, plays, and other performances on the stage, all becoming living archives of an impromptu community, subject of an archive as a process, never fixed or complete at any moment, but endlessly transforming and growing. I will show you a short video of one performance we made with an archive. This performance by Gyeonggi folk song singer Lee Hee-moon is a reenactment of the disappeared traditional community culture in which village men enjoyed a kind of rest and play in a hut-like room created by digging out the ground during the off-season. Actually, if you can see this, archive materials were projected on stage and audience were part of the archive as they were on stage, listening closely to the sound without a microphone and adding sharp together. So, the exhibition began with an archive about Dure, a farming community who helped one another with the field work in the late Joseon Dynasty. In doing so, the exhibition was not intended to present this collective community activity as a prototype to be restored, but rather focused on the sentiment of liberation found in the chorus of the Dure Rainbow Song, which enabled farmers to forget their pains of labor while working together. So when a pioneer sings with a farm instrument, the compositional characteristic of the labor song, which other farmers would sing along saying, "Way to go, farmers," is a cross between the space and time with the concept of ritornello described by the French philosopher Félix Guattari. The concept of ritornello proposed by Guattari refers to the harmony as a recurring phase that we find in the existential territory of life. It means each person has a certain unique beat that provides a constant rhythm to their own flow or cycle so that he or she may feel the life of time. As seen in the behavior of birds, which seduce their sexual partners through a certain song sequence or create peculiar sound to intimidate intruders, this ritornello phenomenon, which tries to give harmony to the repetition of everyday life, is a work created by the natural desire of the people. So the point Guattari emphasized through this concept was that labor under today's capitalist system made everything identical and boring, making life impossible to create harmonies on their own or to design their life as a play. Actually, in every community, ritornello exists as such an autonomous chord. People have the ability to create their own beats and rhythms to form the harmony of the group. In fact, such characteristics of harmony exist even in the murmur noise and the noises of groups. The Finnish word balutuskuro, meaning complaint choir, is an expression referring to a situation where numerous people are complaining about something at the same time. The complaint choir first started in Birmingham by Tellerbo and Oliver Kalainen in 2005. It's an open source project that gathered daily complaints of people living in certain cities, made into lyrics and made with local musicians to produce songs that were performed in public space. Well, I will show you this one. For the Balutuskuro in Seoul, organized for this exhibition, 20 volunteers expressed various complaints against the background of Seoul, which were staged, made in into a song by Korean musician Han Bat, and were performed on a stage made in the museum and in venues around Gwanghwamun area in Seoul. The participants made trivial complaints related to actual ways of life, such as why must store employees always be friendly and only customers may complain? Why are workers of art organizations not allowed to create unions? Please don't act like an old fossil. So the complaints were made into lyrics and described issues affecting youth in Korean society in this age of neoliberalism from individual viewpoint. They not only freely sang and danced to share joyful emotions, but also formed a certain sense of solidarity due to repeated strong choruses. Okay. So, as a result, communities pursuing such alternative lives are able to compose its own lively and rhythmic lives, not in the time led by capitalism through the ritornello. Ultimately, a performance archive attempted in this exhibition was an archive as a process, transforming and growing. On the stage of the Platza Maiden exhibition, performances reinterpreted the researchers' archive were held every week. For example, jazz musician Kim Sung-bae reinterpreted the Nongyo archive recorded by folk song researcher Isora, and Siren Eun-young Chung's women's cookbook archive was reborn as a performance by the women's guguk actress Namunjin and gay choir G-Boys. So every individual spectator became a subject of the archive and intervened in the historical materials recorded by the people. So this was a small starting point with the possibility of recreating community society as a new alternative. And the second section took place around the archive tables, undergoing research on 8 different approaches on communities. The archives spread out by socialists, historians, and philosophers, activists, design researchers, and artists not only penetrate the concept of modernity to demonstrate the deconstruction process of traditional communities, but at the same time also focused on the diverse cultural movement unfolded by the voluntary solidarity of this repressed or newly created subject in the press of social growth. As if the researchers' desk and bookshelves were moved into the museum, the audiences wandered in the exhibition space, which is staged like a joint laboratory, and reclassified the materials according to their own rule. Such special production is contrary to the general concept of archiving based on systematic categorization. So during the past decade or so, the archiving community has raised the need to collect materials and build archives reflecting people's ordinary lives and to conduct interdisciplinary research. And there have been movements to carry out archiving from below in an effort to overcome the elite model and document the actual build of life. This exhibition was an effort to present archives produced by ordinary and creative subjects and to recompose the collective memories of communities. For such archives of the everyday to gain authority as a field of alternative knowledge production, solidarity and practice is demanded not only of the archive community, but also by researchers undertaking joint efforts in various academic fields and diverse civil society groups. The exhibition presented archives focusing on the documentation of ordinary people's lives carried out by researchers, activists, and artists of diverse disciplines in relation to modern urbanization in various ways. Socialist Joan has been tracking the life of a family for over 30 years, starting with her field study in the summer of 1986 on a rundown residential area in Sadangdong, Seoul, and awaiting demolition for urban redevelopment. Her documentary Sadangdong Plus 22, produced by observing the life of the family of Grandma Kim Sung and her children, moved into a rental apartment in Sanggye-dong after their neighborhood in Sadangdong was demolished, and following the family through the grandchildren's generation over a period of 22 years, revealed the structure of poverty as it is handed down in our society. And she seriously asks, did communities ever exist in Korean modern society? And during the time that demolition of old houses in Sadangdong was being recklessly implemented in the mid-1980s, a new middle class emerged in Gangnam area of Seoul. Design researcher Park Hae-chun's archive, focused on their aesthetic taste, was formed based on apartment complex culture, a selection of series of articles titled House Fashion Worst Theme, published in the popular middle-class magazine of the 1980s called Deep Spring Water. And interestingly, Goodbye Dunchun Jugong Apartment Project, done by publisher Yin Gyu. I'm sorry. Together with those who were born and brought up in large-scale apartment complexes built in the 1980s, formed a generational distich with Pakichan's archive. After almost 40 years as their apartment complex hometown confronted the fate of disappearance due to the redevelopment, the apartment kids born in the 1980s gathered voluntarily on and offline to collect their personal documents related to the place, starting an active archive through publishing, filmmaking, and urban ecology workshops. Going beyond just documenting what was disappearing, they carried out projects to safely relocate the trees that formed the forest and the stray cats living there, thus playing the role of switching urban and housing policy to a perspective of ecology and humanities through solidarity. Such transition of paradigm to an archive of everyday life, focusing on documents of ordinary people's lives, ultimately contributed to revealing the capitalist phenomenon of alienation hidden in the daily aspect of their lives. This process serves as an important mechanism revealing ordinary people, minority groups, and lowly subjects as the main agent of society and history. A new archive model that the exhibition sought to build was a practical platform to visualize and broadcast the archive being produced and reconstructed on the spot. To the end, throughout the exhibition period, the spontaneously generated community activities were continuously featured and updated on diverse media, including SNS platforms and local community radios. Based on this new media environment, the exhibition presented community art practices taking place simultaneously on and offline, web projects made with the participation of numerous individuals and provided platform that audiences could actively utilize. I think time is over, so I will just briefly pass this slide. So this is a file timeline made by eight kind of Twitter writers. So they are just accumulated daily kind of documents they wrote around their lives, everyday lives. And this is Mediate, which archived the activities of the village community media group, the presenting program organized by local students, housewives, sewing factory owners, etc., who personally presented their areas of interest with microphone in hand. So ultimately, the exhibition sought to endlessly ask what is the archive of this era and to embody a free community where people are not tools of production but subject who cultivate their own destinies. So this can become possible by converting archives into the everyday in humanities based on the lives of individuals in diverse groups from various levels of society and documenting their memories rather than something that is organized and managed by authorities, agencies, governments, and those with power, and by popularizing the archive so that anyone can access it and change the record. Okay, thank you very much.
OK， 谢谢曹淑贤的分享。因为我觉得他的这个例子也是向我们进一步展示，就是说我们今天在亚洲，比方说这个迅速的都市更新这个空间的变化的这样的一个过程当中，其实档案其实它变成了也是一种沟通和连接的媒介了，就是它不是一个 死的空间，就是它也是不断的在跟日常生活跟人的这种活动在发生密切的关系。所以其实我最早提到的很多关于亚洲档案理论生产的这种可能性的时候，我觉得这些例子也都会给我们提供很多的启发。那我接下来其实有几个问题，就是想同时问两位讲者。那第一个其实就是来回应我之前最早的一个思考吧，就是说当档案这个词，这个英文词 archive 这个英文词，当它来到你们各自的这个语言的语境里边的时候，它是产生了一个什么样子的变化，如果有的话，那么它的首先这个是涉及到就像我刚刚讲的中文对于 archive 这个字的这样的一种翻译，那么在韩语和日语的这样的一个语境之下，即使它是音译的，是不是你们觉得这个字在日韩两国的这样的一个，或者说在你们具体的这个案例里面，你们觉得是不是会有一个不同的一种对于这个概念的一种增加吧？那么这是第一个问题。第二个问题，其实我觉得我们这个就是我们三个人也正好是来自于中日韩三个地方，而且都是女性。那么刚才大家就是听到的你们的分享当中，其实松泽的这个案例里边，其实我们也没有好像听到很多跟就是说这个性别相关的这个议题，因为我自己也在翻译的过程当中注意到松泽对于女性的这个身体，或者说女性的这个意象的它的这个使用，其实也是一种某一种程度上我觉得是有一种工具化，但是它可能更抽象为一种生命象征的这样的一种意义的。那么但是它的这个档案里边对于真实存在的女性的这样的一个思考有没有，这个是第二个问题。那么在曹竹贤的这样的一个分享里边，当然我也听到了有一些关于这个不同的这个性小众群体的这样的一个，但是从女性的角度来说，这样的一个archiving 的形式，或者说这个档案化的这个形式里边，你觉得女性扮演了一个什么样子的角色啊？可能先这两个问题吧。对，那就是哪一位先开始都可以。
Well, I will I'd like to talk about the actually word of archive at linguistic concern you actually around rules, because we also use the word wenshin, that is munhon in Korean pronunciation, but it only refers to documents and publication usually in library, so we also generally use English word archive as it is. But I don't know this would be properexample as your interest, but I found a very interesting linguistic meaning referring Korean traditional archive system, which is Shilluk. Shilluk is actually the most representative of archival tradition in Korean history, and it was to document the king's task according to the old Korean record management system.So the bureaucrats who produced the Shilluk were similar to Western archivists, but they play a role in turning events they have seen in the court around King's life into stories as raised by the court's management and historical descriptions. And I found that the dictionary meaning of Shilluk is aRecord of writing facts as they are, but there is another meaning of a story a story or novel decorated with a mixture of fantasy with facts. So it was an interesting discovery that the Korean traditional archive was a recording method that adds fiction and literary elements.
Mm-hmm. 很有意思，因为这个可能又是跟中国的这个情况可能也有相关，但是可能也有韩国自己的这样的一个传统。那日语呢？
Well, in Japan, its archive is, as you said, it's phonetically archive. You know, we don't have to use even kanji, the translation. So,You said it's 文献 in Chinese is sometimes used, but it's more for the official documents. And then there's 公文館, like the archive of official papers, documents. But other than that, we just really archive seems to be quite new concept. And also for fine art, they sometimesKind of confuse the archive and collection. And then those also the materials that should be considered as archive is normally they go to 図書館, like library. So yeah, there's some kind of confusion of the concept between archive and library and collection.And because of the lack of the funding and the manpower, there are hardly any really like functioning archives in Japanese institutions, only that the national 図書館 I mentioned, and that the like, private ones like Keio Art Center Archive. But I think that museums are not, now some are building like a Monoha Archive, but then it's really quite new phenomena.
明白，所以其实我也是在日本调研的过程当中，我也发现这个问题就是在亚洲的这个档案的研究和理论化的过程当中，首先遇到的阻碍就是很多的概念我们其实是没有一个有共识的一个定义的，所以因为没有共识的定义，所以后面做的每一步走下去，可能大家都在走不同的方向，所以可能就是比如说这个你刚刚说的这样的一个这个藏品收藏品跟档案库之间的这样的一个区别，比如说我记得这个喜马拉雅也很熟悉这个土方就是就是这个不透 dance 这个舞踏这个 archive 的这个收集，那么包括像曹朱贤刚刚说的这样的一种就是转瞬即逝的这样的一种 archive， 不论他是一个艺术家的还是不是的，那么这个他到底他的本体是什么呢？这个收藏起来的本体究竟是什么呢？是只是他的表演呢，还是所有跟这个艺术家或者这个团体相关的所有的文字的档案呢，还是什么呢？我就在这个研究的过程当中不断听到这样的问题，就是说我们没有一个，或者说这个艺术家的跟其他人的书信来往呢，其实松泽佑的这个档案里边有很多，其实他书信来往本身就是作为一种，艺术的形式了。那所以就是说，究竟这些东西哪些能够被归纳到，就是纳入到这个档案库里边，哪些是要被排除？在外，这个是谁来决定？然后我们是不是能够慢慢的来形成一种共识？是怎么样子？所以这些基础的问题，其实我觉得还有大量的工作要做。所以我们的这个整个的一个讨论跟这个研究，也是希望能够慢慢可以一起去讨论面对这些问题。那第二个关于这个性别的问题，我想。可能两位也有一些话想说。
Well, for the Matsuzawa archive, well, it's Matsuzawa's artwork itself too. I mean, he dealt a bit about kind of sexuality, not very direct way, very abstracted, like this pink color, pink, and also some certain languages he used in his work. It's kind of quite feminine, or you can see kind of bit of mixture of, you know, like gender, the language. But then that his commune or community of Nirvana, they're only two female artists, both of them dancers, belong to one dance group. So it's very much of men's club. And also as this small community in Suwa, although it has very ancient history and the very strong spiritualism, its community itself, it's still now that those who are running the everyday politics and et cetera are all predominantly male still. So to get to preserve that the female experience of the Suwa, which I tried in the last couple of years with some other artists from outside, it's still very difficult. So I'm sure in 70s at the Matsuda's time, he even didn't have, you know, like even, I don't think he even really tried in realistic way. But so his concept of, you know, gender is very much conceptual.
OK, 好啊，那 曹珠先生有没有补充一下？
I'm actually very conscious on the kind of fictional aspect in the archive, even though I just made an example, gave example of the Shilluk in Joseon Dynasty. But I also very interested in the kind of fictional aspect in archive in terms of the possibility to, you know, reconstruct the history and stories. Well, I found a very kind of interesting Korean novel that shed light on the lives of three women who did communist women's movement in the 1920s. So I just made the exhibition with the archives of that area, that period, and especially with that women's activities. So the novel is based on a true story that the author researched in archives of Korean newspapers and magazines in that period of time. And he also made a fiction by her imagination only in the part of their lives that had not found or remained in archives. Actually, one of the characters was the first female journalist for a Korean newspaper company. And three of them wrote for various magazines to engage in communist and women's movement. So we can find quite enough documents recorded in newspaper and magazines at the time. But what surprised me was that before the novel published, no one had ever heard of such intense intellectual activities as the women's enlightenment movement as well as the independent movement. Of course, the historical evaluation of communists in Korean political situation is insignificant, but men's cases that sometimes found in textbook and the media, but on the other hand, for the case of women, especially if they are communist and feminist, their names and existence have been completely gone. So during my research for that exhibition, I thought that women's names and activities should be formalized and treated like the male-centered history. Also, I think that women should naturally become the subject of history beyond the limit of gender identity distinction in community. So in this regard, I think the performance by women Gukguk actress in solidarity with the gay community at the Women's Gukguk Archive by artist Eun Young Chung was a very meaningful attempt. I don't know if you know Gukguk or not, but Gukguk means national traditional performance, so referred to the Korean traditional performing arts. And so after liberation, women's Gukguk was formed in opposition to the male performance centered scene. But it, I think the attempt to unite as a community of minorities rather than a dichotomous division of gender makes it possible to spread and sympathize more widely without deepening social division, because the problem of social division is too serious in Korea at the moment.
Yeah, okay. I mean, 就是两位这个女士她们的这个研究过程当中肯定也会遇到很多就是非常就是虽然这是一个非常具体的一个case， 但是它其实也是跟日常政治或者说是一些非常具体的一些观念上的问题其实是会产生很多的这个碰撞，所以不管是性别的问题，或者是一些就是甚至就是有一些体制的这种问题，因为我对这个喜马大桑的这个 case 了解的更多一点，就是包括有的时候这个比方说长野县自己的这个美术馆对于松泽的这个。他的这些留下来的这些藏品或者是他的这个档案，他以怎么样的一种态度和方式去接近，其实这些都是一个非常现实的问题。有的时候完全把艺术家原来的这个想法是破坏掉的，然后是不可逆的这样的一种破坏也可能正在进行当中。那我觉得这两个例子总而言之，包括我刚刚最早跟大家分享的这样的一个书的这个这个目的，其实也就是让我们把这个 archive 从背景拉到前景就是它不再是只是一个我们可以想当然的它永远在那里的这样的一个空间一个场所，而是说它其实不断的还在跟我们现在非常多的这样的一些重新思考历史记忆和日常生活的一些事件在发生着非常密切的关系。那么这个在 chat box 里边有一个问题，就是说关于如果说这个档案库无法被人去看的话，那还有什么意义，就是说他说这个甚至是 AAA 都不能够完全让其他的人，就是让这个想使用他的人来就是去看他所有的一些藏品。那么所以我们是否能够认为这个档案库始终是一个精英的而不是一个为大众服务的这样的一个存在呢？那么我觉得其实就是我刚才强调的这一部分，就是说我们的确还有很多非常精英的档案库但是所以我们的研究，从研究者的角度或者从艺术家和策展人的角度可能我们还是要把更多的目光放在一些还没有就是可以公开的，然后我们甚至是这样的一个去建构这样的一个更公开的这样的更公众具有公众性的这样的一个档案库的努力，来包括对他的这种努力的一个记录或者一个档案。那我觉得这个的确就是我们所有参与这本书的作者包括我自己在内的一个愿望。所以我不知道两位有没有对这个问题有自己的回应。
Yes, I think that accessibility is very important issue, especially, as I said, that sometimes some archival materials in Japan are in collection of the museum, then it's almost impossible to have access. You know, they consider as a valuable something. So, and then another way is digitalization. I think AAA is very good at digitalizing. And that has more, it's a lot more accessible even, you know, from overseas. But then it's going quite slow in Japan. So yeah, it's we are still on the process of making more things available to public, and also open as Matsuzawa imagined, making it interdisciplinary, so people who are not expert can have access to the archival materials.
Dr. Cho, you have anything to add about the accessibility? 或者关于这个能否使用这个 sorry, 能否使用这个答案库的这样的一个问题, 就是在chat box里边提到的这个问题, 有没有想要回应的?
Yeah, I saw the interesting question on the chat box, and I totally agree with you, absolutely, the digitalization of public archive should be opened. But I'm concerned about the personal data produced through internet or SNS platform. Those are used commercially or politically without even realizing it sometimes. In the case of personal data in SNS platforms, they might remain immortality, because you two actually discussed a lot about the ability to the death in the archive this discourse. But the kind of digital archives is immortal. I mean, it after we die, our data is still alive. So evaluation of ourselves may be manipulated at will by future generation will take that image. So in fact, there is a possibility that anyone can reconstruct record of big data. So again, I'd like to emphasize on the community cooperation from the local communities and experts and personal memories, etc., in the matter of digitalization as well.
Yeah, I think that the digitalization is, it's great, but then I don't think that's like, you know, answer for everything. As you said, it could be it could be immortal, but then it could just also disappear, you know, all of a sudden. Like, it's especially like Matsuzawa's archive, there are lots of mail art and correspondence. Those are like in physical form, letters, writing on paper. So I can see the authenticity through their handwriting, and also that the quality of paper, you know, dated materials, etc. But then without this kind of physical evidence, I mean, I don't know how in the future archivist or art historian really like check on the authenticity of emails. And also when provider disappears, like AOL and you know, other providers, it could just disappear unless you just archive your the email in your storage somewhere. So I think that it's, yeah, it's important to digitalize, but then I don't think that's, yeah, that doesn't solve all the questions, the problems.
Mm. 这个我觉得又可以回到刚才就是松泽的那个我说 2018年的时候 喜马达桑带我去长野去拜访的他的那个房间 因为这个房间我记得当就是在我去拜访之前的不久 是在横滨三年展上 有人就想试图把这个整个房间 就是拷贝到这个展场上去。那么然后我记得当时西方德桑对我说，这个做法，即使你把一个就是把所有的东西按照原样去把它复制到一个展场上去，这个行为本身还是就是没有太大的意义，即使你可以复制的一模一样的东西。因为尤其是我当我去参观这个房间的时候，我觉得比如说对我来说到现在还印象非常深刻的一个东西是，比如说他的这个房间是在如果我没有理解错的话，是在两层的中间，所以他我进去的时候是不能够站着走进去，我是要斜着把自己塞进去，然后进去之后是一个非常暗非常潮湿然后你可以看到上面都是灰尘，甚至你闻到一些潮湿味道的这样的一个空间。那我觉得这样的一个就跟其实曹忠贤讲的一些非常你必须在这个地方发生的一个非常 site specific 的这样的一些所谓的这个档案的这样的一个东西相比这个很多数码的东西是没有办法去取代的。那所以这也是为什么我觉得松泽的很多的东西后来包括这间屋子是不是也已经没有了，因为很多就是当地的这个长野县的这个美术馆的这些人员，他们认为保存物件本身而不是空间是更重要的，所以这些理念上其实有很多冲突，跟我们就是跟我们做研究的这些就是这样认为的研究者来说，其实这些官方的或者说美术馆的这种做法其实是对我们来说是无法接受的。不知道是不是这样西马德桑。
I think this is a very difficult decision that we made, that the museum made. That side room doesn't exist anymore, as you said, that the museum got the grants and then they digitized, they took photograph of everything and then packed all the object into the box and then moved away. That's because of the threat, this earthquake. It's the structure is too weak. So next big earthquake, this whole thing might collapse. So yeah, I think that's probably the best choice they have made. But then as we see, it's that location itself, it's in the sewer and it's in the Matsuo's house that is over 200 years old and whole atmosphere. And also it's has been changing. It's not static room. I mean, it's not just Matsuo's works, but then other artists added and subtracted things as well. So unfortunately, some people took the photograph and the videos over the period. So I think we have the record. But yes, I think that the whole the existence more of the atmosphere and all that is gone. And I think also some people said if it's not in sewer, it doesn't mean anything because it was so much attached to the legacy and that the spiritualism of the location.
我甚至认为如果这个房间在地震当中被毁掉，可能松泽会更开心。或者说这个他其实并不一定一定是说我的这个档案就是要让它对永久的存在那里，就是这个也是跟这个德里达讲的那个死亡的冲动也有关系。但是我觉得松泽在这个方向上，我觉得是跟德里达是差不多的想法。朱贤不知道有没有还想要补充的。
Well, just backing to the Shimada-san's concern of emails archive. Well, I think archiving email has value as an original, because as emails data is also effective as legal evidence. in Korea. I don't know other countries, but in particular, the problem of the originality of historic data can be given the original value by using blockchain technology like NFT. Probably that will be the one way to archive as historic type as original.
Mm-hmm. 是的啊 ，OK， 那我们时间其实刚刚好，然后好像也没有更多的问题进来了，所以，那我想，我们今天的讨论就差不多到这里结束。非常感谢，喜马达桑和曹朱贤的这个参与，然后也了解到两位的这个过去和到现在的这样的一些这个实践，这个档案实践。那就像我刚刚说的，如果大家对我们这个项目有兴趣的话，那就请关注我们的公众号和其他的这个网络的平台。我们5月28和29号会有两天的很集中的这个圆桌讨论。